Good morning. Good morning. Happy New Year, everyone. It is great to be with you. So excited. How many people stayed up till midnight last night? Who did it? Okay, quite a few of you. Well done on making it this morning. I planned to go to bed at 9:30 last night, and I failed horribly. I think we stayed up till midnight, right? That was a mistake. Anyway, we almost brought in the new year. It was great. Yeah, that's great. Thank you. So I have a couple of New Year's resolutions. Do you? Anyone else in here have New Year's resolutions? A couple of people? Really? Only a couple of people? All right, I've got one. I'll share mine, and maybe that'll make you feel more comfortable in sharing yours. My main resolution this year is to actually go to the gym that I signed up for last year. Edge Fitness, right over here on 14. So that's like my main resolution, is to actually use the thing that I signed up for. I was looking online of like, what are the most popular resolutions for 2023? And when I looked at it, it was very similar to what it was like the year before. And it's typically kind of always the same thing, isn't it? I want to eat healthier. I want to lose weight. I want to exercise more. I want to spend more time with family, less time on social media. I want to save more money. Like, it's kind of always the same stuff, isn't it? But I think it's really interesting. Every single year, we're talking about New Year's resolutions. People are making them. Now, whether they stick to them is like a whole other subject. But the desire is there for almost everyone, right? Maybe you've had like a really crazy last couple of years. Maybe, they've been crazy. Let's be honest, right? 2020 till now has been just kind of a wild ride. And maybe things haven't panned out exactly how you thought they were. Or maybe you've neglected some things that have been happening in your life. And you're getting to 2023 and you're like, all right, new year, new me. We're going to make some changes. I'm going to put some things in place, right? We have that desire to better ourselves. And we try to do that all the time, right? It's actually a really admirable thing. It's not a bad thing at all. I don't think New Year's resolutions are cliche or lame or anything like that. I think that they're great, and I think it shows the desire in people to want to improve their life, to want to grow in something. The only thing that I see about New Year's resolutions, though, that I maybe have a little critique about, is that if you look at all of the New Year's resolutions that happen, almost all of them they're almost always exclusively material things, physical things, right? Whether it's losing weight or saving money or spending more time with your family or whatever the resolution is, it typically always pertains to the material world. It always pertains to the physical. Rarely, if ever, do we have kind of spiritual resolutions. So I thought this morning, why not talk about a couple, maybe, right? Why not talk about maybe a couple of spiritual, instead of calling them resolutions, let's just call them convictions. And so that's what we're going to be doing this morning. We're going to talk about three convictions of the new year. Three convictions for the new year. And if you have your Bible, we're going to be in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 18. And if that word that I just said was new for you, conviction, like what is that? A conviction refers to the state of being convinced and confident that something is true. It means a strong persuasion or a belief. Another way to say it is it's not something that you grip, it's something that grips you, right? It is that strong of a belief. You're persuaded that it's true. It's not something that you're gripping onto. It's something that truly grabs hold of you. That's a conviction. And so these are three convictions that we're going to find in 2 Corinthians 6, 14 through 18, that I think is going to help us as we look toward the new year. Here's the first one that we're going to see, is that my relationships matter. My relationships matter. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Starting in verse 14. It says, "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? Stop right there. You notice Paul is doing something here. First, he starts off with something called an imperative. This is a command. This is an action, right? Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. Then he follows it up with five rhetorical questions. And what Paul is doing in these questions is he's proving the imperative to be valid. He's showing by these rhetorical questions, look at this contrast. That's why this imperative is valid. That's why this command is valid. And he's contrasting these things for us to see really clearly, right? He shows it like what partnership do those who do right have with those who do wrong, right? Righteousness and lawlessness. What fellowship do those who live in the light have with those who live in darkness? What accord does Christ have with followers of Belial or Satan? What portion do believers have with unbelievers? What agreement do worshipers of God have with worshipers of idols? It's such a contrast there that you know the answer to that is what? Not at all, right? None at all. There is no agreement. There is no portion. There is no accord. There is no fellowship with those things. And so then, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. Well, what does that mean? Maybe that's some new terminology for you. And I think that this helps because Paul is really giving us a picture, and it's a picture of this right here. That wooden piece in the middle is something called a yoke, and it would go around two oxen who were pulling a burden, whether it be a plow or a carriage or whatever, and a team of unequally yoked oxen would be maybe a stronger one and a weaker one, or a taller one and a shorter one. And the stronger and taller oxen would always pull faster than the weaker. And so it would veer them off course. In fact, it would make them eventually spin in a circle. And so this is the image that Paul is giving. He's saying, don't be unequally yoked. Don't have a weak and a strong next to each other, or else it's going to get off track. It's going to not be able to perform the task that is set before them. Instead of working together, they're going to be at odds with each other. They're not going to get to the destination, right? Paul here is stressing the importance of relationship. Do you notice it's a yoke standing side by side, connected together? Do you see the imagery? He's talking about relationships. Some people think that it applies only to the marriage relationship. It doesn't. It's more general than that. It's talking about relationships. He's stressing how they're important because they impact us in a very deep way, right? They're important in keeping us on the straight path to Christ. Being alongside other believers, pulling in the same direction. And if we don't, if we're unequally yoked, then we veer off the path, or we go around in circles. And we know this to be true in our life, don't we? That relationships shape us and affect us. We know this to be true, whether positively or negatively. We listen to advice. We heed warnings. We learn from them. We tend to act like the people who we're in relationship. We mimic their behavior. We participate in the things that they like to do, right? Relationships matter because they shape us. And this verse, taken at face value, seems to say, well, don't have relationships with unbelievers, right? At face value, that's what it seems to say. And that's how many people actually interpret this verse. Well, I just have to cut out all of the unbelievers in my life because this verse tells me that I should do that. That is not a right interpretation. That is a wrong interpretation of this. That's not what Paul is saying, and it isn't congruent with what the rest of Scripture says. And so there's actually a really important nuance that's happening here and that we have to look at, right? Jesus, for example, was the what of sinners? Friend of sinners, right? He had relationship with sinners. He ate at their tables. He met with them. He associated with them. Nicodemus being one of the, you know, more famous people that he associated with. He didn't engage in their sinful activity, but Jesus certainly had relationship with unbelievers, yes? Paul himself, in his earlier letter to the Corinthians, in 1 Corinthians 5, verse 9 and 10, he says, I wrote to you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people. Verse 10, not at all, meaning the people of this world who are immoral or greedy or swindlers or idolaters. In that case, you would have to leave this world. You see what's happening? Paul is not contradicting himself here. He is not saying, his argument is not that. His argument, his point is that in your mission towards holiness, which is the mission of every Christian, in your mission towards holiness, which is all of our mission, that we need to surround ourselves most closely with, we need to yoke ourselves next to people who have the same purpose and goals, which is holiness and Christ-likeness. The people who are closest to you should have the same goals so that you can work together towards holiness. And if those relationships, all of those relationships that you have are not like that, they don't share that goal, you're going to veer off course. The snare of falling into worship of idols of this world or the snare of being led off course into lawlessness is large because relationships actually matter. So how do we navigate this nuance? Like how do we practically in our lives, how do we make sure that we're navigating this correctly? Well, I'm gonna be drawing a little bit today. Hopefully this works. I think about it like this, in concentric circles, if you will. So there's our first circle. Can everyone see that? Yes? Circle? Perfect. This here is, this is intimacy. You probably can't read that, but that says intimacy, all right? And this is your first circle. This is the most important relationships in your life. So in my life, this is my spouse. This is Kelly. This is the kids. This is my family, right? The most intimate relationships that I have. The ones who can speak directly into my life, who have full access to every part of me, who have full transparency into my life, who I listen to on a daily basis, who sanctify me constantly. That's the first circle. This is the intimacy circle. Then you have the next concentric circle. This is influence. This is influence. These are people who influence you, but also people whom you influence, right? So this is a broader category of people who are still close. They are still in strong relationship with you, but you're influencing them, and they might be influencing you as well. And then we have the last circle, which is care, right? So for everyone else, we care for them. This is the Christian ethic, right? There is no category of person that we put like outside here, whom we hate them, or you know, they're excommunicated. There is no category for that. The category is we care and we love even our enemies, right? And so this is kind of the way that I think about this. And when I think about this, and specifically about being unequally yoked, I think about this center circle right here. My most intimate relationships are those with people who have the same goals and the same mission. Are they following after Christ? Are they going to push me towards Christ? Are we going to yoke together and be on the straight line toward Christ? Is that what's happening? That's my most intimate relationships. I want to make sure that that's happening in my life. And the rest, we put boundaries around those, right? We have wise boundaries. And maybe you've been in some toxic relationships. Maybe you look at this and you're like, man, I don't really have any intimate relationships with people. I don't know really what that looks like. I mean, this is the year, 2023, perfect time to start getting some intimate relationships in your life, to start maybe moving some of those toxic relationships, right? I think here's a question that we should always be asking ourselves. Is this relationship bringing me closer to Christ? Is the relationship that I'm in with this person, is it bringing me closer to Christ? If the answer is no, then boundaries, right? Maybe you need to switch up what circle they sit in your life. Because the most intimate relationships that you have should be reserved for people who are on the same mission as you going towards Christ. That makes sense? My relationships matter. Here's the second thing that we're going to see is that where I go, God goes. Where I go, God goes. Let's look at verse 16, right at the end of 16. So he has the five rhetorical questions. And he says, "For we are the temple of the living God. As God said, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." What Paul is saying here is very, very significant. It's very significant for us. He says that we are the temple of the living God. You see, the temple was the place in Israel where the presence of God dwelled. It was like this place where heaven and earth collided, and the veil was torn back, and God's presence rested in the temple. It was a physical place where the Lord's presence was. And so if you wanted to be in God's presence, you had to go to the temple. You had to go someplace. You had to go to the temple. And what Paul is doing here is he's flipping that whole idea on its head. He's flipping the whole thing over. And he's saying, no. Listen. The temple, God's presence, where God's presence rests, it's no longer a place. It's now a people. It's not a place where you go. It is a people. He's flipping it on its head. The presence of God is now dwelling in you. It's dwelling in you. This is because we have received the Holy Spirit, who is God. At the moment of our salvation, we have the Holy Spirit literally dwelling in our hearts, in the heart of every believer. And now we are the temple of the living God. And the presence then of God goes wherever we go. Because we are the temple, the presence of God goes wherever we go, which can be both amazing and terrifying, right? It's amazing. It's also super terrifying. It can be terrifying because he goes with you wherever you go, all right? Think about that for a moment. God goes with you wherever you go. Some people think that they can hide from God. Think that they can sneak away and God's not going to, they can escape the view of God. But the truth is that he's with you. When you're sinning, he's with you. When you're making bad choices, he is with you. When you're thinking sinful thoughts, he is right there. You can't hide from God. So what's terrifying about that? Like, is it scary because he's like a cosmic version of the elf on the shelf? Like, is that why we should be terrified? He's always watching, sort of thing. No, that's not actually why we should be scared. The reason that we fear in that moment is because of God's purity. If we're the temple and we are close to the presence of God, the thing that we fear is not that he's the elf on the shelf watching. It's because his purity. It's because of his holiness. Because his purity and holiness are both transcendent and incredibly dangerous. I like to think of it this way, because I'm a very visual person. I think of it like the sun, right? So think about the sun. It is transcendent. It is beyond kind of our ability to think about how hot it is and how far away it is. It is so totally removed from us, right? It is so far away. It is so transcendent above us, right? But the sun is also interesting in the fact that the closer you get to it, the more dangerous it becomes, right? The closer that you get to the sun, the more dangerous that it becomes. God's holiness and his purity are a lot like that as well. Do you remember Moses in the burning bush? Right, what does God tell him? He tells him to stop, take off your shoes, don't come any closer. Why? Because it's holy ground, and what'll happen? He'll die, right? Terrifying. What about when Moses is, he's asked to see the glory of God, right? What does God do? Puts him in the cleft of the rock, and he's like, no, you can't see my full glory. Why? Because it'll kill you, right? What about Isaiah when he's in the throne room of God? What is his first action? Woe is me, a man of unclean lips. It's to immediately purify himself in the presence of God. Why? Because his purity, his holiness is dangerous for the impure to be around. It's dangerous. And so if we are the temple of God then, the place where God dwells, then it should be a place of purity because his presence is near. And maybe there are some things that you're even thinking about right now that maybe need to be cleaned up in the temple. Maybe some attitudes or some actions that you've been engaging in maybe in this last year, this last season, that just need to be cleaned or cleansed. But here's the great news for us in all of this, is that Christ has already done the work on the cross. He's already done all of this work on the cross. We don't need to work really hard to cleanse ourselves. What we need to do is we just need to do what the scripture tells us, which we see in 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Do you see that? He does the cleansing. He cleanses us. We just need to humbly submit to him and confess. Say that, God, I got it wrong. I was going the wrong way, and I submit to you, Lord, and I'm going to do it your way from now on. So God's presence can be terrifying, right? Can be, because of his purity, but it's also amazing because he goes with you wherever you go. His presence is with us wherever we go, and this should actually bring us an incredible amount of comfort. Like, he's not only there in our sinfulness, he's there all the time. In your weakness, he is there, and he is your strength. When you feel like you're not enough, he is there, reminding you that you are a son or a daughter of God. When I'm fearful, he is there, telling us to not be afraid. When I'm brokenhearted, he is there to bind up our wounds. When I step out in faith, he is there empowering me. When I'm not sure what to do, he is there to lead and to guide. And when I'm tired, he is there to give rest. When I'm anxious, he is there to give his peace. In the highest of high moments in my life and the lowest of low valleys, he is there. He is near. He is with you. Because his presence goes where we go. Because we are the temple of the living God, he is with us wherever we go. I wonder what would happen if we lived like that was actually true. What if we lived like that was actually true in our life? That we really believed and had a conviction that God was with us wherever we go. How might that change the way that we view circumstances in our life? How might that grow in us a conviction to grow in our purity? How might that increase our worship for God as we see him at work in our life, as we know that he is near? What if we actually believed that he was with us every single place we went? Here's the last thing. Being different is what makes the difference. Being different is what makes the difference. Let's look at verse 17 and 18. It says, "Therefore, go out from their midst and be separate from them, says the Lord, and touch no unclean thing. Then I will welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty." So Paul, in this whole section, if you notice in your Bible, if you're reading it, you can notice that this part here looks a little different than the rest, right? It's kind of, it's in quotations. What Paul is doing here in this part is he's putting a couple of Old Testament verses, he's kind of smashing them together, actually, and summarizing them. And what he's doing is he's bringing these Old Testament promises into the New Testament, but just applying them just slightly differently. And that's what he's doing right here. When he says, "Therefore, go out from their midst and be separate from them, says the Lord, and touch no unclean thing." Where this actually is it's found in Isaiah. It's where that part of the passage is found. And it was a call for Israel, an actual, real, physical departure from Babylon, who was a nation who worshipped idols, right? It was a call to leave, to actually depart from that place. But now Paul is bringing it into the New Testament. He actually changes some pronouns here to make it absolutely clear that that's what he's doing. And he's applying it a little bit different. This isn't now a call to leave physical Babylon, really depart from a place called Babylon. What it is now is it's a metaphorical departure. To separate ourselves from the world who worships idols. That we are to be different. Some people say set apart. Some people say consecrated. To separate from them, to go out from their midst, meaning the world who worships idols, not individual people. It's not engaging in the practices of this world. And that separation, that difference, do you see it here? It makes the difference. Because I'm a temple of God and because I worship God, I separate myself from idol worship and the values of this world. Then it says, I will welcome you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Being different makes the difference. We are called to be separate, to have different values, God's values, the values of the kingdom versus the values of the world. So then what does being separate mean? Like, how does that actually play out? Like, practically, how do we do that? And I think that this is actually a place where a lot of people get messed up. So how does this actually work out? How do we be separate, right? Have you ever heard the phrase, we are supposed to be in the world, but not of the world? How many people have heard that phrase before? Like, almost everyone, right? Yeah, we're to be in the world, not of the world. And that's actually the high priestly prayer that Jesus is praying for us in John 17. And it's what people talk about when they talk about being separate, right? When people are like, oh, we need to be set apart. We need to be separate. It means that we need to be in the world, but not of the world. And then they don't explain what that means. And you're like, yeah, in it, not of it. Got it. And then they just interpret it any way that they want to interpret it, right? Because they have no idea and no one's explained it to them. What does in mean and what does of mean? Like, how are those different? And I don't, you know. Well, see, you're in it, right? It's not of it, right? It's confusing. So I want to give us another drawing. Sorry. I'm going to give us a matrix because I'm a nerd. And not the movie. It is, all right, I guess we're going with purple here. So I'm going to give us a matrix to think about this, okay? Can everyone see this? It is a box. Now it is a box with four boxes. Everyone got it? Yeah, okay. So it's got two axes, right? This here, the vertical axis is counterculture, okay? Okay, make sure I spelled that right. Right, another way to say counterculture would be God's values, all right? And then this axis here, this axis is going to be common good. All right, and so the lower left portion here, this is the lowest countercultural, and it is the lowest common good. Does this make sense? It's clear? Okay, so this is, I've already messed it up. This is of. So when people say, don't be in the world, not of the world, what does of the world mean? Of the world means it means the lowest countercultural and the lowest common good. That's what it means. It means a low distinctive Christian life. It means that someone could not look at your life and say, you know what? That's a Christian, because they don't look any different than the world. They have all of the world's values, and they're not working towards any of the common good. That's of the world. Does that make sense? All right, we've cleared it up. Now we're going to go to for the world. This is being for the world. This is low God's values, low counterculture, high common good. Think about this in the vein of social justice, right? Which is a great thing. But this is that vein of still looking like the world in values. I'm still going after what the world values, success, money, beauty. My values are still the same as the world, but I'm trying to look out for the common good of my neighbor. I'm trying to care for those around me, right? That's for the world. Then we have, I think, which is probably the most common, which is against the world. This is where I think we find most Christians, because when they see the word separate, this is, I think, typically where it leads them, is to be against the world, okay? High God's values, right? High counter to the culture of the world, but low common good. And the reason low common good is because they have actually physically, literally separated themselves from the world. They have stepped so far back, they have created a Christian bubble that exists around them in which they have no interaction with the world whatsoever. So when they see, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers, they take that to mean don't know any unbelievers, right? Just don't associate with them, don't talk to them. High God's values, low common good. They are against the world. And this is where I think we find so many people. And this is why I think it's important to really look at this and to know what does in the world mean then? Of course, so in is right there. It is high God's values, high common good. High counter the culture of the world, high working for the good of my neighbor. I am out on the front lines having relationships with unbelievers, right? It's high common good, high God's values. That's what it means to be in the world, not of the world. And I think as we're looking at these passages, as we're talking about what being separate means, what being different means, what that all looks like, we have to keep this in mind, because I think we tend towards against the world, which leaves us in a Christian bubble, not advancing the mission of Jesus Christ in the world. So we've got to pop that bubble. We have to actually be in the world, but not of it. And now we all know what that means, right? Happy New Year. Happy New Year. So, like I said, being separate doesn't, being different isn't separating yourself completely. It isn't just doing good to those around you. It's having high God's values, and it's working for the good of your neighbor. I want us to just close with this. It's chapter 7, verse 1. And this is really the goal of what Paul is getting at here. I know that it's a different chapter, but it's all connected together. Chapter 7, verse 1 says, since we have these promises, what promises? The promise of being the temple of God. The promise of God dwelling among us and walking among us, and him being our God and us being his people, and him being our Father and us being sons and daughters of the Lord Almighty, those promises. Beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from every defilement of body and spirit, bringing holiness to completion in the fear of God. This is the goal. Hold on to these amazing promises, cleanse ourselves from impurity, and grow in holiness. So let's make 2023 different, church. Amen? Let's be intentional with our relationships because they matter. Let's know and believe that God is with us wherever we go. And let's be different because it makes a difference. Let me pray for us. God, thank you for this morning, that we can come together and celebrate a new year and to worship you. And Lord, thank you for your word and your instruction to us. Lord, I just pray that as we are thinking about this next year, Lord, we're thinking about the things that we're looking to change, to grow in. Lord, I just pray that you would bring conviction with that, Lord, spiritual conviction, That ultimately, Lord, yes, training in the body is of some value. But training in godliness is of much more value. And so, Lord, would we be a people who are intentional with our relationships? Lord, would you help us to navigate that nuance with clarity and wisdom? Lord, would you help us to realize and to remember that wherever we are, you are there with us. For we are your temples. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us to continue to grow towards holiness. We can only do so by the power of your Spirit in us. Lord, I pray that you bless this year that we have ahead of us. Let us grow closer to you, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name.